What is global warming doing to the Caribbean's coral reefs? Ecosystems, coral reefs, hurricanes, and watershed management. That's up next on Carib Nation.
This is Carib Nation Television, the source for news and information about the Caribbean and the diaspora. Seen locally in the Washington, D.C. area on MHZ Network, Saturdays at 1:30 p.m. and Wednesdays at 11:30 a.m. and on the World Wide Web at CaribNationTV.com. Carib Nation, the television for one people, one culture, one Caribbean, one nation.
Hello, welcome to Carib Nation. I'm Daris Dean. Today we are talking about coral reefs, watersheds, and ecosystems. My guests are Alexi Boado, who's a consultant, and Mark Aiken, who is a coordinator of NOAA's Coral Reef Project. Thank you so much for joining us, and welcome to Carib Nation, both of you.
Thank you.
Let me start first with you, Alexi. Mm-hmm. We hear terms such as watershed, ecosystems. What is a watershed? How does one recognize it? What does it do?
I think you could say that if you think of a bathtub, a watershed is sort of not necessarily an arbitrary division, but it is a very flexible definition of an area that collects water and drains it off to one point. So you can think of your bathtub as a watershed, and a watershed could be the size of this room, the size of this table. It could be practically the size of, you know, a state or bigger. Mm. So a watershed is a very variable term. So maybe the valley between two mountains would be the watershed, and the river that discharges through the center would be, you know, representing the stream or the bathtub, the drain of the bathtub.
Mm-hmm. So if you have a country like Guyana that has so many tributaries and canals, that the watershed would be what, the largest river there?
No, it could be the smallest river. The watershed could be the smallest headwater, could be considered a watershed, or it could be the entire watershed. It could be a tremendous valley. It could be the entire Amazon River watershed, you know, which is almost the entire continent.
I see.
So it's really quite variable.
Well, we'll come back and talk about what happens with watersheds and why they're so important. But I also want to talk to you about, Mark, about coral reefs. Mm-hmm. Most of the Caribbean islands are either buffered by or sit on coral reefs.
Or both,
yes. Tell us, why are coral reefs so important to the Caribbean or places like the Caribbean, and why we have to protect them?
Well, coral reefs are extremely important ecosystems. Number one, you mentioned the buffering. Many places, coral reefs provide an excellent buffer to waves coming in. So when you have severe storms, or fortunately we haven't had tsunamis much in a long time in the Caribbean, but you know, any of these large waves get buffered by those coral reefs sitting offshore. Mm-hmm. So that's the start of it.
Then is that sand created?
They do. There are a lot of things that erode the coral, natural things. The sea urchins will chew at the coral and break off bits. The parrotfish will do it. If you've ever been swimming and seen a parrotfish, it'll go along, it'll munch on the bottom a bit, go swimming on past there, and you see this beautiful little cloud behind it as it's dropping what they always drop. Uh-huh. But a large part of that is sand, actually, that there's then spreading across the bottom. So there are a lot of natural forces that break up coral reefs, and the corals at the same time are always working to build it.
Hmm. I see. Now, let me come back to you, Alexi, and talk a little bit about management of these watersheds and whether you consider that the Caribbean or places like the Caribbean are doing a good job? I've read that mankind has done a lot of damage. Mankind has not taken care of these watersheds as we should. What are some of the things that we have done, and how can we correct some of these things?
Mm-hmm. Watershed management really consists of, as we think of it in the urban and suburban context, it really is the control of two parameters. It's the control of the water quality parameter and the water quantity parameter. When we talk about quantity, we talk about rate and volume of stormwater. So when you think about urbanization, even in the District of Columbia where we're filming this today, we have a really huge problem dealing with the stormwater flows, the volumes. When you have so much imperviousness as you have in an urban context, you have these very flashy, high volume flows. So we're treating rainwater, stormwater, as a sort of as a waste product, and we're trying to push it away from our watersheds as quickly as possible to protect our homes from flooding, you know, to protect our basements from flooding. And we're sending that water to our streams, to our headwaters, to our larger rivers as quickly as we can. And so the engineers have been very good at doing that, but the net result is that our streams are heavily degraded because of these, the volume and intensity of these flows. Think of it sort of as a fire hose effect, turning a fire hose on a sandy beach and watching all that sand wash away. Well, that sediment acts as a sort of pollutant in and of itself. It also, not only is this release of that sediment from the stream a type of pollutant, but oftentimes that sediment in an urban context is has different pollutants associated with it. Could be fertilizers, could be heavy metals. And all of that will wash downstream. In addition, it creates a lack of stable habitat in the stream environment. So you don't tend to find viable populations of benthic invertebrates and fish in these urban type environments because you have these flashy flows that are constantly eroding the banks and eroding the stream bed and moving the system. And so you don't have that stability for, you know, for habitat creation. So you have this volume issue, this rate and volume issue, what we call quantity. And then you of course have the quality issue. The quality issue being all of the pollutants, particularly in the urban environment, that we discharge to our waterways. That could include heavy metals, pesticides, fertilizers,
certainly phosphates and things like that. Absolutely.
Detergents. If there's manufacturing processes, it could be copper. It could be changes in temperature. Just imagine a very hot day, you know, when it suddenly starts to rain and you have, you know, 70 degree rain hitting 120 degree asphalt and that temperature shock, you know. And in systems such as coral reefs that are highly sensitive to changes in temperature, you know, the temperature, these changes in temperature regime, you know, can be very problematic. So when we think about modern stormwater management in the urban context and even in the agricultural context, it's really about these two parameters, quantity and quality.
Well, let's then talk about how this will affect, or how the, how does it affect the coral reefs in areas where we have these barriers, we have these protections, we have ships coming in as one of the areas, I suppose, where you can point to as creating damage to these reefs.
There are a number of major things that impact coral reefs and the health of coral reefs. We do a lot of work on climate change, so the big factors that are influencing coral reefs around the world. And what you're getting at here is some of the very important local impacts, two of which, one of them is overfishing or destructive fishing, and the other really big one is getting at land-based sources of pollution. And this ties right back into the watershed issue. So that's when there's too much sediment coming on the reefs that can literally smother the corals. And it's also bringing with it those nutrients that you were talking about just a moment ago. You know, as the watershed collects all of these various nutrients that are running off, if there are improper farming practices with too much fertilizer, or if it's coming from things in human households, in cities and such. Either way, these processes that Alexi's been talking about in terms of feeding all of this water down enriched with nutrients, brings sediments. When that flows out onto the coral reefs, it now changes the water chemistry, the quality to these reefs, and can have a major impact, a deleterious impact on the reefs.
What we do every day, or what we do in the Caribbean every day or anywhere, has a major impact continuously on coral reefs.
Absolutely, because everything that is being done on land ends up being washed down into the water, and that's where those reefs are.
And that is something we don't think about. I think we just go about our lives and don't realize how much damage we're doing. When we come back, we're going to talk about what that damage then in turn does to us. How do we suffer as human beings in our everyday life and what we do? We'll be back with more on coral reefs when we come back after this break.
You're watching Carib Nation Television.
When America wants to know what's happening in the Caribbean diaspora, there is one clear choice.
Hello, welcome to Carib Nation.
Both people inside and outside are
very excited about today's program.
Looking at you, I can tell that you've traveled the journey.
One television organization brings America close to the people, stories, and events that affects Caribbean life. Get close, get answers, get Carib Nation.
Welcome back to Carib Nation. I'm Daris Dean. My guests are Alexi Boado and Mark Aiken. And we're talking about coral reefs, especially in the Caribbean watershed and damage to the ecosystems. Alexi, let's talk a little bit about how we impede the work that in a really circular way. Mm-hmm. We're almost impeding what we really want to improve.
Right. Especially in the case of Caribbean nations that rely so heavily upon the allure of their coral reefs, and yet you often see them building, you know, these massive hotels and homes right on the beach, where they have there's absolutely no buffer between the development and the resource that is so important to that development. So it is a sort of vicious cycle and very self-destructive.
Right. Do you get the feeling that the governments have bought into or understood how tourism can make an impact on their very livelihood in terms of protecting what they're really trying to sell?
I don't think it's always 100% clear, the direct relationship between the resource that is bringing in money from tourism and the need to protect that same resource. They're often at odds with each other. And really it's because of the way that we choose to develop those areas. Mm-hmm. People want to be right on the beach. They want to be right next to the coral reefs. And as soon as you have that imperviousness, that those surfaces that convey rainwater and stormwater directly to these very sensitive coral systems, and to any system for that matter, the Chesapeake Bay being a case in point, you have these deleterious effects. And if you combine with these changes in quantity of stormwater and changes of rate of stormwater that's delivered, if you combine with that human sewage issues or agricultural pesticides, you tend to have these aggregated effects.
Mm-hmm. Now, the other issue that we have to worry about in the Caribbean, of course, is hurricanes, storms. How then does that storm damage affect the coral reefs that we have, because we see the water surging, the waves get bigger and rougher, and I suppose that helps to erode the reefs and the beach. So explain that relationship for me in terms of climate change, the hurricanes, and how it all comes together.
If you think about what hurricanes do, and what any storms do for that matter in terms of sand, is they move the sand around. Mm-hmm. Now this is an important thing to remember about beaches. Sand moves. Sand is going to move. Sand is always going to move. You know, if you glue it all together, you turn it into concrete or cement. You know, it's concrete. I always forget which is which. But yes. You know, when you make it solid, it's not going to move. But then it doesn't do what it's supposed to do any longer, and you lose a lot of things that you really need. The structure of sand is actually really good at protecting the shore because it does move out. It absorbs some of that impact. It moves out and then it slowly moves back in and builds up. So you have to have dunes that are healthy and have the ability to move back and forth and to be able to have that reserve of sand. When you build a hotel right on the beach, you flatten the dune, you put in a hotel, you've got a beautiful flat beach. But then when the storm hits and the beach does its job and it sort of erodes away a bit and goes to come back in, the problem is you lost a lot of the sand that was supposed to be a part of that system.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's going to tend to move away, get drifting, drift offshore. The other thing that happens is that sand on reefs and the rocks and things move around and do start to impact coral reefs. And they hit reefs, cause damage to the reefs. But what we have to remember is that hurricanes and coral reefs have been going together for a long, long time. Hurricanes are nothing new. Coral mm-hmm. reefs have had hurricanes around as long as they've been around. So in a natural system, if everything's healthy, the hurricanes are just a part of that system and it's not a problem.
So they're not necessarily one of the key reasons why coral reefs are damaged?
Absolutely not. They are a part of the natural system. They do damage to reefs, but, and there's a paper that we have that's going to be coming out shortly that was led by some folks in the UK, looking at the damage of hurricanes and what they do, that even if you increase hurricane damage, the reefs should be able to recover. The problem are the other things we're doing, like getting back to the watersheds, the excess sediments coming onto the reefs, the excess nutrients on the reefs, and with climate change, with the warming temperatures, the bleaching of the corals, that the damage that occurs during hurricanes, the corals can't grow back the way they should. In fact, there's actually something that's kind of interesting when it comes to hurricanes and coral bleaching and global warming, is that when you have a period and the temperatures are really warm and you get into the problem of coral bleaching, those are periods where the water is calm, it's warm, you get this nice hot water, and you start having the problem that hot water, the way it causes bleaching. We can talk about
that. Yes, I do want to talk about that.
But the interesting thing is, it's that calm water, it's those warm conditions, they're stagnant, that cause this.
Hmm.
Hurricanes, though, when they come through, can actually cool the water back down, bring cool water up to the surface, mix it up, and can actually be good for the reef if they're not too close. So this is a big difference between the just horrible bleaching event we had in 2005 and the bad bleaching that we've had this year in 2010, where in the northern part of the Caribbean, in the Virgin Islands, the U.S. and British Virgin Islands, Puerto Rico, up in that area, 2005, there were no hurricanes or tropical storms coming through to cool the water. And they just boiled.
Mm.
This year, we had lots of storms coming through, and that actually cooled things down. So hurricanes, while a lot of people think of them as being an enemy of the reef, are a part of the natural process and actually are helping with some of the problems we cause.
I see. Coral bleaching is something we hear a lot about. Mm. And as you said, because of the warm water. Now, is coral bleaching something unique to these warm areas, or do we have, because of climate change in other areas, that warming of the water? And how common is coral bleaching in the Caribbean?
Well, coral bleaching occurs, and it is occurring now, in all of the waters where we have coral reefs.
Hmm.
You have warming going on all over the world. So, I mean, just like you hear about the problems in the Arctic and the increase in iceberg breakage and ice sheets and the glacier melting and so forth, that's happening up there. But anywhere that you have corals, which are the warm areas of the world, we're seeing these extra warm temperatures coming along. Well, it really didn't start until the early 1980s. That was when we saw the first large-scale mass bleaching event that happened across the eastern tropical Pacific and in through the Caribbean. Since then, we have had now, and with 2010, we're up to our sixth bleaching event since 2005, significant bleaching event.
Mm-hmm.
we're seeing these events coming back over and over again. Other areas in the world haven't been getting it as often, but it's still a major problem. And in fact, in 1998, there was a major bleaching event. Actually, it was 98 and into 99. Major bleaching that occurred all across the world, all of the major world's oceans, we saw bleaching. And now in 2010, it's only the second time that we've seen that sort of global scale bleaching occur. So in the Caribbean, we've seen a lot more frequent events. On a global scale, we're seeing it as well. And it's really one of the biggest impacts to coral reefs. And the problem is, you know, independent of what you do locally, good or bad, climate change and the warming of our oceans is just causing this overwhelming impact to coral reefs all around the world.
Now, coral reefs have been around for thousands of years,
yes,
as I understand it. Have they then been damaged before and been reconstituted or somehow been rebuilt? Is this a natural cycle of life? Or is it that this time we're really doing the worst? Or does each generation believe that they're doing more damage than has been done before?
I think that it's like a series of insults to these systems that are perhaps unique. You know, the coral bleaching events, they might have happened, you know, as, you know, as Earth temperatures fluctuated, you know, over the last millions of years. But I think that this series of insults at once, which include changes in temperature, and also these non-point sources of pollution from the watershed, are really taking advantage of these corals when they're in a weakened state. So it's really adding an insult to an injury, and I think that's the real danger here, is that you have the global warming effect, you have these changes in temperature exacerbated by fertilizers,
right,
you know, depressed oxygen
behaviors.
Right, human behaviors, exactly.
Mm, I see. So basically what we've just compounded the issue.
Exactly.
That's right. There was one major event that occurred about 50 million years ago, where coral reefs were exposed to really warm temperatures, high CO2 in the atmosphere, knocked them back, but they did come back.
Mm.
It took about, there were actually two events. One time it was 8 million years, the other was 18 million years before they came back.
Wow.
Do you want to wait that long?
No, thank you. We'll stop for a break and we'll be right back after this to talk some more about what to do to correct some of the problems we have with the ecosystems. We'll be right back after this short break.
This is Carib Nation Television.
Welcome back to Carib Nation. I'm Darris Dean. We're talking about coral reefs, the damage to coral reefs and the ecosystems as a result of global warming, climate change, etc. And my guests are Alexi Boado and Mark Aiken. In our last segment, and we have just a few moments, but I'd like to get to some of the remedies. What would you say would be the first or the most important three things that a government or a tourist country has to consider in order to stop or reverse these conditions?
If I had to generalize about Caribbean countries and coral reefs, and this isn't very different from what we're facing here in the United States, it's probably three things. First of all is advanced sewage treatment for human waste. So removing as much nitrogen as possible from sewage before that effluent is dumped into the ocean, which is usually where it ends up.
Mm-hmm.
The second would be control of agricultural sediments, using, you know, better agricultural practices to make sure that after they've removed crops, that soil is not left bare to be washed downstream during the next rain event. Mm-hmm. That's number two. I think number three is reduction in imperviousness in development and trying to mimic the pre-development hydrology. So trying to mimic whatever forest or whatever ecosystem was there before humans came and put in parking lots and roofs and roadways, is to try to mimic those infiltration rates, to move that precipitation back down into the aquifer. So those would be definitely the top three, and they really don't vary between a tropical system and a temperate system, for example. Those are the same issues we face.
Now, are there alternatives that people can consider or think about? Can any of you, in the last couple of minutes, suggest alternatives that, apart from the structural and behavioral things that we have to do, as you mentioned, protect the make sure that we don't have the runoff from agricultural, we treat our sewage. what else is there that, what are the alternatives that some of these poor countries don't have a lot of money to do, but the, as you're saying, this is where they should be putting their money?
I would say from the watershed perspective, at least, I think things that aren't necessarily expensive but are easy to do and that don't require a lot of technical training are to infiltrate your stormwater runoff from roadways, from homes, back into the ground. And infiltration practices are relatively simple from an engineering perspective. Mm-hmm. That is something that people could do on their individual homes, and also choosing other ways to develop land so that you don't increase your imperviousness, using pervious pavers or gravel instead of cement.
So the water goes
so the water will move back down into the watershed. Right.
Any other suggestions?
The last thing along those lines that I can think of that's so important is when you're clearing land, when you're putting in roads, make sure that you're not allowing the sediment to get into the ocean. Mm. It's so easy to have that happen. So that means when construction is going on, you have to have proper barriers. Mm-hmm. You want to get in vegetation that holds the soil as quickly as possible, reduce the erosion in the drainage by putting in good vegetation and making sure that roads have an ability for that water that runs off then, if for example they're gravel or dirt roads, for that water to be caught and have that soil stay put on land, because you know we need the soil on land and the reefs don't need it in the water.
Great point on which to end, and we have run out of time, but thank you so much for joining us and explaining these systems to us. It's something that we need to pay more attention to, and I'm sure we can pique the interest of our nationals to do a better job at protecting their country. Thank you so much for joining us again in Carib Nation.
Thank you.
And thank you for joining us in Carib Nation. Until next time, I'm Darius Dean.